CIL 650 presents It's Your Money, an up-close and personal look at your finances. Here's your host, Fred Snyder.
Up in the morning and out to school.
Okay, we're back. Live for the next 2 hours, talking to you about your money, more importantly, about your money and how to keep it. The key word in that sentence is keep. We work all of our lives to earn money. When we go to school, they teach us how to earn money. So we devote a great deal of time to the process of generating income. We end up broke. Statistics tell us that if we take 100 people to start at equal today, at the age of 25, by the time they end up at 65, one is wealthy, four are well-to-do, five are still working, 36 are dead, and the remaining 54 are dead broke, dependent on family and state. Why do we fail financially? Is it because it isn't important? I don't think so. There's an old saying that goes like this. Having is the result of being. You must become. You must change. How do you change? We're going to talk about that today. We're going to talk about affirmations. We're going to talk about how you modify your behavior by using affirmations. How you can program your subconscious mind by using affirmations. Because ultimately, your subconscious mind is what will determine your future. Someone once said, if you want to predict the future, create the future. You can create your financial future today by having a well-documented written financial plan. And over 90% of the people I talk to every day do not have a well-documented written financial plan, a blueprint that says, this is where you're at right now, here's where you want to go, and this is how to get there. A financial plan will tell you precisely what you have to do to get from where you are right now financially to where you want to go. And the best way to get that is to give me a call on this station and talk about your finances or make a meaningful contribution to the show. I do seminars and workshops. I dedicate my time and my energy to the pursuit of teaching people how to change, how to become, how to evolve so that you are the kind of person that attracts wealth. My favorite book is the book Think and Grow Rich. I have studied that book from cover to cover. I prepared slide presentations based on that book to teach people what they need to know to make better financial decisions. So get on the line, give us a call, let's talk about your money and how to keep it. I have to take a quick break. Want to go to break? I'll come back in a minute.
Fred Snyder.
Statistically, if you take 100 people who start out equal today at the age of 25, by the time they end up at 65, one is wealthy, four are well-to-do, five are still working, 36 are dead, and the rest are dead broke, dependent on family and state. That's over half the people who start at equal at age 25 by the time they end up at 65 are dependent on family and state. And that's a sad state of statistics.
Fred Snyder.
You need a blueprint that says, this is where you're at right now, and this is where you want to go, and this is the way to get there.
Fred Snyder.
So isn't it time to get that good, warm, fuzzy feeling because you know exactly where you're at? You know that your investments are going to work for you. You know that you have the right investments inside your financial plan. You're confident about the future because you've covered all the bases. You know exactly how much life insurance you need, and you have the right amount of insurance. You have a financial advisor such as myself or somebody that's equally competent that you can check with to determine whether you're on track or not. And whether you're on track or not, you know, I like to use the analogy, do you have a GPS?
Fred's got your GPS. Talk to Fred. Listen to Fred. Fred Snyder. Sunday mornings, 9 to 11 on CIL 650. This is CISL Vancouver. Smooth and easy. This is It's Your Money on CIL 650. Here once again is Fred Snyder.
Slight technical problem there. Sorry about that, ladies and gentlemen, listeners out there. Again, to link us back to where we left off, we're talking really about your subconscious mind and how to program your subconscious mind. Your subconscious mind dictates everything that you are, everything that you will become. Your every move in life depends upon your subconscious mind. And you really have to find a way to communicate with your subconscious mind. I would highly recommend that everybody listening to this show go online, download the book. It's a free download, Think and Grow Rich. Make that your Bible, because I will be talking about that book on each and every show that we do, because really it's about motivation. The word motivation is made up of two words. First part of it is motive. The second part is action. Nothing happens without a motive, and nothing happens without action. You're not going to get to where you want to go financially unless you have a motive, which is goals, and unless there action takes place to achieve those goals. Napoleon Hill in the book Think and Grow Rich says that anything you can vividly imagine, ardently desire, believe you can, and enthusiastically act upon will inevitably come to pass. Now that's any goal, whether it be losing weight, whether it be social activity, it doesn't really matter what it is. It can be money. It can be any goal that you want to set. So I'm about success. How do you succeed in life? And having, if you want things, you must become. You have to attract wealth. All you have to do is read or listen or watch some of the stories involved. It's been on CNN and various places from people who have won the lottery. If you were to win the lottery, what would you do with the money? And usually people make huge, humongous mistakes, and they win the lottery, they're wealthy for a while, and then they're broke again because they don't know how to handle money. They don't have a financial plan. They don't know how to take financial advice. They complicate things. They have investments all over the place. They don't understand their investment program. They don't have a plan. And the key word is to have a plan. Later on, I'm going to have Dr. Anne Marie Evers join me, who's an expert on the subject of motivation and actually setting goals and all that kind of stuff, which is a link to this book. And I'm sure that she was inspired as well by the book Think and Grow Rich. All the great motivational speakers of the day, really, their ideas originated from the book Think and Grow Rich. If you could interview, and this is historically as well as currently, all the wealthiest people in the world, even Donald Trump for that matter, if you could interview all these people and ask them, what made you successful? How come you're so successful and most of us aren't? What is the difference? How do you determine that? If you could get a book that would answer all those questions, compile into a book the words of all these great wealthy people on how they succeeded in life and how they became wealthy. If you get a book on that subject, wouldn't you want it? Well, this is the book Think and Grow Rich. It will tell you how to achieve anything. It will tell you how to become successful. We're going to talk today about chapter 12 in the book, The Subconscious Mind, which is the connecting link to everything else. We'll talk about that. And right now I have Dr. Anne Marie Evers on the line. Welcome to the show.
Good morning. How are you doing this morning?
Pretty good, Dr. Evers. You've been on this show before.
I have, quite a few times.
Yeah. Tell us what you do.
Oh, my goodness.
I'm going to leave it wide open so you can give yourself a real big commercial right now.
Oh, my goodness. Well, I've been teaching the power of affirmations for the last, 35 or more years with great results and doing it myself. And, of course, even though you teach and live affirmations, things in life happen. And
Even yourself, right?
Yeah, I've been through, you know, some difficult times lately, but I've been affirming myself all the way through. And that was with, like, you know, some people have, like, I was diagnosed with colon cancer and then got a severe infection and then was taking chemo just about 2.5 years ago, and my husband passed away right in the middle of it. So it's been pretty rough, but you know what? Instead of giving up, I decided to take the affirmations that I've been teaching for 35 years and making them together to methods, strategies, and tools which made up my affirmation life tool. So that's what I'm teaching now. And my oncologist said, he said, how can you be so happy when everything happened to you? And I said, well, I've got a secret. I do affirmations. And he said something, and I said, put one foot in front of the other and keep going. And he says,
never
well,
give up.
Would you like to share it with others? So now I'm lecturing at the hospital and have been for the last 15 months.
Well, you have your own radio show too, do you not?
Yes, I do. Yeah, I have that. And I also talk at Silver Harbor Senior Center and at the Palliative Care Center now with Dr. Sugar. So I'm really busy, and I think what my point is that even though things that are not good happen to us, we can turn them around, because when I felt like giving up, then it came to me, I said, why me, when I was diagnosed with colon cancer? And the answer came back, why not you? You know, you've got a computer, you're a best-selling author, you can write books. How about using all these affirmations you've been using and put them into strategies that can help people, and then sharing them,
and then
write a book?
So Dr. Evers, what is an affirmation?
Oh, I'm glad you asked. Affirmations, for anybody listening that doesn't know, I call them, they're like prayers, wishes, or goals, only they're more structured and specific.
Give us an example.
Okay, like an affirmation could be, you could say, I'm tired. That's a negative affirmation. Mm-hmm. You could say, I can't afford it. That's a negative one. And positive affirmations that I use are healthier and healthier. Me now, bring it to you, and I say, I'm becoming healthier and healthier, and then focus on it. And, you know, the program that I teach is built on 5 building blocks, and the first building block is forgiveness. The second is thoughts. The third is mind power, and I heard you talking about the subconscious mind. And the fourth is affirmations, and the fifth is creative visualization. So, you know, Fred, when you have all those together, you have those 5 building blocks in place, it's really a wonderful, sound foundation to build upon your affirmation program.
Well, no question about it. The affirmation is one of the strongest ways to program your subconscious mind. So I have a PowerPoint presentation kind of guide me along, and I'd like you to share it with me and our audience and so on. So let's proceed with that, okay? I've been talking about the book Think and Grow Rich.
Oh, yes.
What I want to do right now is focus on the subconscious mind.
I love that.
So a good way to think about the subconscious mind is like an iceberg.
Yep.
10% is above water. That's your conscious mind.
Exactly.
The subconscious mind is the portion of the iceberg that's below water, right?
Exactly.
Okay. Yes. And really, the subconscious mind, correct me if I'm wrong, but according to the book, the subconscious mind doesn't know the difference between the truth and a lie.
I believe that 100,000%.
So if you want to be enthusiastic, you pretend you're enthusiastic and you will become enthusiastic.
You fake it till you make it.
You got it. Okay?
Yeah.
So if you say to your subconscious mind, I'm a loser, guess what? You're a loser.
Exactly.
If you say to your subconscious mind, I'm a winner, guess what?
Yeah.
You're a winner.
You have programmed
your subconscious mind, and your subconscious mind it rules your life.
It does. Your
conscious mind is the sentinel that governs what gets into your subconscious mind. If you plant the seeds of weeds in your subconscious mind, there's nothing will grow in your subconscious mind except weeds. You have to replace that.
So the key is this.
How do you program? The key question is this. How do you program your subconscious mind?
Well, okay. I wanted to say that when we do, you know, we make statements and we're self-prophesying. If you say that I'm unhappy, you're self-prophesying. And I like to look at, like, I like what you said about the iceberg. And I like to look at it as the conscious mind is like a captain of a ship. And the subconscious mind is like the crew who obeys the captain's orders. So if you were on a boat and the captain said something to his crew to change course, the crew does not say, what kind of a boat is it? Is it a fishing boat? How many fish does it catch? It doesn't say anything like that. It just, they go ahead and obey the captain's orders without hesitation, without question. And this is what I believe, how we program it is by what we think, say, and do. And words are so very powerful.
Another good way to think of the subconscious mind in modern terms is like a computer.
The subconscious mind
is the hard drive that gathers all the data, and the processor is the conscious mind.
Yeah, that's exactly true, and that is true because people say, oh, you know, I can't afford it. And then a couple months later, their fridge breaks down, and then their car breaks down, and the computer gives up the ghost, and they say, why me? Well, why not you? You've been programming it.
The conscious mind, the 10%, deals with issues such as willpower, analysis, and decisions.
Yes.
The subconscious mind deals with beliefs, values, identity, habits, all that kind of stuff.
And it knows more about you than anyone in the world, your subconscious mind.
And your subconscious mind never forgets anything. Sometimes you can't recall it.
Well, it records everything for all time. And then it's up to us if we want to go and, you know, we can access memories and everything. And just like now, like I look at the conscious mind as the waking mind. Now that's you and I speaking. And then the subconscious mind as the sleeping mind, which is not really sleeping, but it's keeping our hearts going, the blood pumping, without any instruction from us. In fact, we couldn't even tell it how to do it.
Yeah, the subconscious mind consists of a field of consciousness
exactly.
In which every impulse of thought that reaches the objective mind through any of the five senses is classified, recorded, and from which thoughts may be recalled or withdrawn as letters may be taken from a filing cabinet.
Exactly.
Now, those words were written in 1937.
Yeah, imagine. And they're still true today.
Yeah, absolutely true.
Isn't that amazing? No, but I know the subconscious mind is so, you know, we don't realize the power we have within us. And some people say they can't do this, they can't do that. Well, things that you don't even think could ever happen can happen when you're in the flow. And, you know, it takes a little bit of work in a way. Now, you wake up in the morning, you can say, oh, God, morning. Or I wake up and say, good morning, God. What am I going to spook out today? So today I'm spooking out talking with the famous Fred Snyder.
I kind of want to summarize up on the subconscious mind. So the first point was it consists of a field of consciousness. Every impulse which gets in there by way of the five senses is recorded. The second part is it receives and files these impressions or thoughts regardless of their nature. Whether they're true or false doesn't really matter. It records everything. And the conscious mind acts as a sentinel because you want to keep the crap out. You don't want to get junk in your subconscious mind because it really directs your life. This is why people can't change. I remember one time I attended a workshop, a seminar. A guy by the name of Jack McQuaig stood up in front of everybody and said, how many people in this room, there was probably 100 people in the room, how many people in this room would like to be perfect? Put your hands up. A lot of hands went up and a lot didn't. He said, well, some of you guys are lying because I know that every one of you wants to be perfect. Who would ever turn that down? So he said, if you want to be perfect, there's a simple solution. Make yourself perfect. And you can't because your subconscious mind struggles all the time with the crap that you put in there, and you have to be able to program your subconscious mind if you want to change. The reason people can't quit drinking, lose weight, etc., 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 we all know what we have to do to be happier and more successful. We all know. Then why don't we? Because we have the struggle, and the key, the soldiers that you have to fight that are what?
Well,
affirmations, right?
Affirmations and all.
And affirmations is your specialty.
I love them. I can't imagine without living without them.
Now, I know there's a lot of people listening to this show right now that have cancer and other health issues, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. I'm sure there's a lot of them out there. So give us some examples of some of the affirmations you use to deal with your medical issues.
Well, what I did was when folks out there no, when you're first diagnosed with cancer, the first thing that comes up is disbelief, shock. It's almost like, you know, a death sentence.
Give us an example of an affirmation that you use.
Well, when that happened, I have to admit, when they said to me, you have colon cancer, all of a sudden everything stopped. My whole world seemed to stop. And I thought, okay, that's it. Now what am I going to do? And then one of the affirmation life tools that I teach is the apple. And I thought, I tried to swallow the whole apple of the things that were happening to me in my life, the diagnosis of cancer, the infection I had, and then my husband passing away.
I want to hear an affirmation, Doctor.
And so the affirmation I did was that I've got to cut it up into pieces. So what I did was I took a piece of the apple, in my way and cut it up. And I thought, I did an affirmation that I was going to find out everything I could about cancer, colon cancer. Another affirmation I did that I was going to find out everything about infection, how I could make it better, and how I could keep from having cancer.
When you looked in the mirror, Dr. Evers, what did you say?
I said, I denied it. I said, this is not going to beat me.
That's an affirmation.
Yes. I have been given a diagnosis. This is not good, but I accepted,
that's an affirmation.
Yes, I accepted the worst at that moment, and then I immediately started to improve upon it. And I said, and I am becoming healthier and healthier.
That's an affirmation.
Exactly. So then, you see, but I had to accept it first, not to deny it.
Accept it. That's an affirmation.
Yes, yeah, I accepted it, and then I thought, what can I do about it? And then I changed it, and I started focusing on the good things. Then I looked at all the things I could do to help myself and to be more conscious of my body and to know what I was feeling so I could share it with my oncologists and doctors, who, of course, only see us for maybe 15, 20 minutes once a week or once every 3 weeks, but we live in our body 24/7. So I took what the information I had from within, and I just made it into... It wasn't overwhelming because I took it piece by piece, mm-hmm. and I believe that doing affirmations, when you do them,
you don't make them too long. That's one thing that you don't do, because
exactly.
you can only chew so much food in your mouth at a time.
Yes, exactly, and that's a very, very good point, Fred, because that's why I have short form affirmations. And see, my short form affirmation was healthier and healthier me now. So I brought it to me.
That's a good one.
Yeah. Another one is, I am becoming healthier and healthier.
Every day.
Every day, yes. Now, I am now becoming healthier and healthier. Because you see, Fred, I couldn't say I am healthy, 100% healthy, because I knew I wasn't at that point. So my mind mm-hmm. would not agree, and it would cancel it out. So when I said I am becoming, my mind could believe that.
Dr. Evers, when it comes to wealth, what would be a good affirmation? You look in the mirror, you give yourself an affirmation when it comes to wealth. What would be a good one?
Well, it depends on the person, of course.
I want an example.
Yeah. Okay, well, you look in the mirror and you could say, what I do is I say, wealthier and wealthier me now.
That's good.
Yeah, because that is bring it to. And then I say, I think about what big money to me is. So I say, big money to me now. And I say, you know, and I start visualizing it and seeing that money, and I bring in the five senses.
Okay, let's take some calls. We have some callers on the line right now. Let's talk to Victoria from Langley. Victoria, welcome to the program.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. And last time you were on the program was May the 2nd of last year, and I liked your talk, Ben.
You must have a photographic memory.
And I very
either that or a good logbook.
Very much like it now. But anyway, I'm going through some health problems too. I have to have a mammogram on Monday. I don't know. I have breast cancer. I have a lump in my breast. But I'm thinking very positive about it.
Okay. And what you can do is that's what you do, think positive and say, you know, that's what I did. Everyone is human. And when we have a lump in our breast or we have a pain like I had, we've got to face it. We can't just hide it under a bushel. We've got to say, okay, I have a pain. I have this. What am I going to do about it? And then you improve on it. And what we can do is we can affirm that it is benign. And you can also affirm, too, that you are becoming healthier and healthier. And if they say, you know, really, they say that you have to have surgery, now I don't think they're going to, but if they do, what's going to happen is then, you know, they know so much now. They can do so much. And so many people are, myself included.
Well, I fully believe. I've never had so many health tests in my life as I have in the last 2 weeks, and they've all come back positive. But on April the 4th, I have to go for a colonoscopy because they're sending me for that because of different reasons. But, you know, I'm very positive. I'm a very outcome. But the majority of the people, 7 out of 10 times, they have a negative thought. I try to reverse that, and 7 out of 10 times have positive.
Victoria, very well said. You may, you know, the third point on your subconscious mind says you may voluntarily, we talked about this in different words before, but you may voluntarily plan in your subconscious mind any plan, any thought, any purpose which you desire to translate into its physical or monetary equivalent. In your case, Victoria, physical, not necessarily monetary, but Dr. Evers, what would be a really, really good affirmation for Victoria right now?
Well, I think what I did was I'm strong.
I don't want to know what you did. Okay. What would be a good affirmation?
I am getting through this. This is not beating me. And you don't want to say, not I beat this right now, or I come through this and with triumph, and I come through this with my this health challenge. And I would just be positive and say, this will, you know, this too shall pass. And that's very important, too, to say, because the fear that comes up is always fear. And I know that fear comes up to everyone, and fear is, you know, like they say, you know, but I say fear is find enlightening answers readily. And so when you find it out and you'll know what it's about then, Victoria, and then you're going to be able to work with it. And
oh, I know. I will that fully. And, you know, like you say on your program, what does rich mean to different people? Well, right now I'm having a little bit of financial, not issues, but not problems. But to me, rich is right now is I don't owe anybody a nickel. I far every month my bills are paid. Right now that is rich to me.
Yes, and build on that.
Yes.
That's a positive. Always build on the positive. Another thing, too, is I use the 1%. You can use the 1%. Today, I am 1% healthier than I was yesterday. Or today, my fear is 1% less than it was yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
And the 1%, because you see, if you said I'm 100% healthy, your mind would say, no, you don't. You got to go for treatments or whatever, or you know, all these colonoscopies and that. So when you say 1% better or 1% healthier, your mind can believe that.
Well, I've talked to many people about this colonoscopy. I've never had one, but I've talked to many people that have, and they said you got to look at the outcome being good, and at the end of the day, that night, you get a great night's sleep.
That's true, and focus on it. Step ahead in your mind and see yourself having a really good night's sleep, a relief, because I've had one just recently, and they tell you right then what it is, so you don't have to wait for days for the outcome.
As soon as you wake up. I had one, too.
That's right, Fred. As soon as you wake up, there they are with it. In fact, I wasn't even out of the whatever it was before they told. So my daughter said, Mom, it's okay, it's okay. And it was really neat because I...
Well, they say 96% of them are positive. Yeah. So that's a positive thing, isn't it?
Yes, it is. You build on that.
Victoria, I'm going to give you one piece of advice.
Okay.
If you have a computer and the ability to download the book, Think and Grow Rich, do it.
I have that book. You've given it to me.
Good. Then
Thank
read
you.
It.
Thank you.
Read it again, and especially focus on chapter 12, which is on the subconscious mind.
Thank you for being on the program.
Well, thank you. And also, Fred, I have some books I'm going to give to you called Affirmations, Your Passport to Happiness. You had some before,
yes.
And I'll have some more when you want to pick them
Wonderful.
Up. They'll be ready.
Okay, if you just tuned in, I'm certified financial.
Bye.
Okay, Victoria, thank
Bye,
you for your
Victoria.
Call. If you just tuned in, I'm certified financial planner Fred Snyder, also a registered financial planner representing Scotia Wealth Management. Wealth management is what we do. What I particularly do is teach people about how to become financially independent, about money and how to keep it. They failed to do that in schools, and I don't really believe they're doing it today as well, and they should be. So I try to fill that void. So my raison d'etre, my mission is to teach people what they need to know to make better financial decisions. And the best way to sum that up is to be successful, you must have a burning desire to achieve something. Right out of the book, Think and Grow Rich. Burning desire to achieve something. Something means goals, whatever they are. Burning desire is you really have to want to. That's about motivation. That's what we're talking about. I have a motivational expert on the show right now who's, that's all she does is talk, period, about motivation, Dr. Evers. And she's written books and she has a webpage and you can log on to her webpage, get all kinds of information. I did that this morning, but I let her do her own commercial, okay? So we're comparing the subconscious mind to an iceberg. The subconscious mind is the 90% of the iceberg, which is under the water. It's quiet. It's still. It sits back there. It gathers information, whether the information is correct or incorrect. But you can actually program your subconscious mind. In the book, Think and Grow Rich, it talks about closing your eyes when you're thinking. Because when you close your eyes, it's easier to communicate with your subconscious mind. You're blocking out the external forces that are out there when you close your eyes. Many great speakers, before they make a point, they close their eyes, believe it or not. That's why they do it. They're communicating with their subconscious mind. It's all in the book. It's a fabulous book. Get it, read it, it will change your life. And anybody who calls the show, I'll tell you what, if you call the show, I'll get you a copy, the book itself, not even a download. I'll get you a copy of the book, Think and Grow Rich. I think everybody should have that book. If you don't have it now, get it. I have to go to the break. When we come back, we'll talk more about your subconscious mind. Don't go away.
Fred Snyder.
Statistically, if you take 100 people who start out equal today at the age of 25, by the time they end up at 65, one is wealthy, four are well-to-do, five are still working, 36 are dead, and the rest are dead broke, dependent on family and state. That's over half the people who start out equal at age 25 by the time they end up at 65 are dependent on family and state. And that's a sad state of statistics.
Fred Snyder.
You need a blueprint that says, this is where you're at right now, and this is where you want to go, and this is the way to get there.
Fred Snyder.
So isn't it time to get that good, warm, fuzzy feeling because you know exactly where you're at? You know that your investments are going to work for you. You know that you have the right investments inside your financial plan. You're confident about the future because you've covered all the bases. You know exactly how much life insurance you need, and you have the right amount of insurance. You have a financial advisor such as myself or somebody that's equally competent that you can check with to determine whether you're on track or not. And whether you're on track or not, you know, I'd like to use the analogy. Do you have a GPS?
Fred's got your GPS. Talk to Fred. Listen to Fred. Fred Snyder. Sunday mornings, 9 to 11 on CIO 650. This is It's Your Money on CIO 650. Here once again is Fred Snyder.
Okay, we're back. We're live. We're interactive. Very, very exciting show, I think, today. It really motivates me every time I read that book. I get excited, and you will too. If you call the show, free copy of the book. I want to have conversations with you, our listeners, about what motivates you, about what you want to achieve, why you're not achieving the things that you want to, because you have a constant battle with your subconscious mind. Every single one of us knows what we want to achieve or what we'd like to achieve, but maybe to get there, we need to be more specific about that. We have to define it more accurately. We have to kindle desire. We have to create this burning desire to get there. So whether it be money, whether it be health, wealth, whether it be spiritual, physical, doesn't matter what that goal is, social, family life, whatever that goal is, you can do it. That's an affirmation. You can do it. Okay? I can do it. We can do it. Maybe that's the way Trump should be talking. Maybe he is. Maybe that's why he's so popular. He struck some kind of a magic chord. I don't know what it is. But it's incredible the politics that's going on in the United States. Think about it. What makes a politician attractive and what makes a politician unattractive? Very, very important issues. So we're talking about your money and how to keep it. That should be a goal. You call the goal my money and how to keep it. Because after all, it is my money. But if you spend it all, it isn't your money anymore. So some of everything that you earn, you must learn to keep. And you got to want to. How do you want to? You got to motivate yourself. How do you motivate yourself? Learn more about the subject of motivation. How do you do that? Get the book, Think and Grow Rich. How do you get the book? Make a bloody phone call. Get on the line, give us a call, 604-280-0650. Long distance, 1-877-280-0650. Log on, www.cil650.com. And if Frida's down at the office, for those who are shy or reluctant to talk on the air, You can call her right now at area code 604-737-3512. If you're calling long distance, it's 1-800-661-1495. Remind you again, we're talking about your money and how to keep it, and the best way to keep it is to want to keep it. And I'm trying to tell you how to do that. So give us a call. Subconscious mind, the subconscious mind first acts on the dominating desires which have been mixed with emotional feeling, such as faith. There's a whole chapter on faith in the book, and really, you want to have faith. Here's the chapters in the book. I'm just going to outline them quickly. I'm going to overview them. First, I'll talk to Kathy from Surrey. Kathy, welcome to the program.
Hi, Fred.
And Kathy, you get the book Think and Grow Rich if you haven't got it already.
I've already got it, I think.
Okay.
I'm waiting for the last one, something about in the wallet, but Frida says you're out. But anyway, I would like to say, like, your financial thing and thinking positive. Okay, I worked hard all my life. Maybe I'm not rich, but I'm rich in everything else. I don't own it. I own everything. I don't owe any money. Okay, so last year I was diagnosed with colon cancer.
Oh, wow.
And I was down a bit. But I wasn't shocked because of the signs and symptoms that I had. And I have a hole in the rectal wall and the vag. I've gone chemo, radiation. They figure one more MRI will say if the cancer's all gone. I end up with colostomy bag. I think positive every day. Even the oncologist, I says, give me a guesstimation on the prognosis here. And she goes, well, maybe 40%. I says, well, that's great. She looked at me like I was dumbfounded. I says, well, you know what? I could be one of the 40%. If you said 95%, I could be either one of the 95% or one of the 5%. So 40% is okay.
That's positive thinking.
Yeah, and I think it was God's way of telling me to slow down or something because I've been so active all my life, and I do. I build things. I do lots of crafts. I'm always busy doing things for people, always helping out. And I think it was God's way of telling me to slow down. So right now I've been in bed for almost 6 months. I don't get too far. And I should say, too, I'm recovering from a fractured hip from my son-in-law who threw a suitcase at me.
Oh, my God.
And I fell on his stoop and broke my hip. That started it, and then the colon cancer. So now I'm just waiting, except I get kind of, I lose my patience because I want things to speed up. And I know radiation chemo takes a long time, like 6 months after the radiation's finished, it's still working. And so it'll be a year in April. And it'll be a year in May that I've had my colostomy and started my radiation and chemo. But I just keep thinking, okay, I'm 63, and God's got a plan for me, and it's going to be on this earth. It's not up in heaven yet.
So what's your favorite affirmation?
Well, you just got to keep thinking little things positive, not big, big, big things. You know, every day think of something positive. Like
today, I'm 1% better than I was yesterday.
Yeah, well, I might not be 1%, but you know what? Maybe I can eat more today, you know, or maybe I can get up and move around more today, or I'm going to try and go outside a little bit today.
So what advice would you give our listeners?
Well, I like Victoria. I listen to her when she phones in all the time. And my daughter had a lump on her breast. And I think she should not worry as much as she's worrying because they've got so many treatments for breast cancer. I think breast cancer is one of the simplest ones to catch and do something about because my daughter had a lump on her breast. That's why I'm saying. So I don't think Victoria should worry too much. She will be okay. They'll do biopsies and, you know, stuff like that on her lump, and she will be okay. It's one of the easier types of cancer.
I know a number of people who were given very little time to live a long time ago, and they're still alive. They've beaten it. Numerous people.
Yeah, I mean, so each one is unique in their own way.
So the message is never give up hope.
Yeah, and you know, I nursed, and I saw lots of people with cancers. Pancreatic cancer is one of the hardest ones. you know, to detect. But the ones that they detect early, they fix them for them, you know? So I think Victoria, she should just keep thinking positively. Don't get down on the dumps. Don't think negative things, you know, and don't...
That just makes it worse.
Yeah, it does. It just like, oh, why poor me? Well, you know what? There's a lot of oh, why poor me's out there that are worse off than me, you know? So don't think, you know, you're the only one, but think you're going to get through this, you know?
Well, Kathy, I can't tell you how much I appreciate your call.
Yeah, it just takes time.
Good luck. And enjoy the rest of the weekend.
Thanks. Bye.
Take care. Okay, Kathy's line is now open. And, again, I don't have to send her the book, but I think I'll send her the workbook. There's also a workbook that accompanies it. So if you have the book, then we'll send you the workbook. And they cost, I think, about $30 a piece. So you get a workbook simply by making a phone call. Okay? And that number is 604-280-0650. If you're calling long distance, it's 1-877-280-0650. Log on, www.cil650.com. Read it down at the office. If you're shy or reluctant to talk on the air, 604-737-3512. Long distance, 1-800-661-1495. Now, don't call Frida expecting to get the workbook. You got to make a contribution to the show to get the workbook. That's how I reward you. All I want is a phone call. I won't embarrass anybody. Just want to have a conversation about goals, how to achieve them, anything that you'd like to share with our listening audience. Like that, anything at all, give us a call. Give the number out once again, 604-280-0650. Long distance, 1-877-280-0650. The chapters in the book, Think and Grow Rich. The first chapter is the introduction. We already talked about that. The basis of the book is compiled in one book, is the success secrets of the 500 most successful people in the United States in the mid-30s. Andrew Carnegie is one of them. Henry Ford is another. Thomas Edison is another, and so on. So if you could sit down with Thomas Edison as an example and say, Mr. Edison, what made you so successful? His words would be worth a small fortune. You can get it for free. Just get the book. Chapter 2 is about desire, burning desire. Chapter 2 says you have to be able to want it enough to have a burning desire. So it talks about how to kindle desire in Chapter 2. Chapter 3 is about faith. You have to believe you can. You have to have faith in yourself. You have to have the iron will determination to pursue your goals, regardless of circumstances, criticism, or what other people say, think, or do. That's Chapter 3 in the book. It's about faith. Very important. Chapter 4 is about auto-suggestion, how to program the subconscious mind. We're talking about that right now. And that's also in Chapter 12. But Chapter 4 is about auto-suggestion. Auto-suggestion is really what we're talking about. We're talking about affirmations. That's the key to that. Chapter 5 is about specialized knowledge. It says, in Chapter 5, it talks about the mastermind group. It talks about Henry Ford. You need knowledge, but you don't need general knowledge. You need specialized knowledge in order to achieve success. Where do you get it? Today, you got your mastermind group, if you have one, or you have Google. You can find out almost anything about anything today using Google. That's specialized knowledge. Everybody has access to that. And if you don't have the computer skills to be able to use Google, you're missing something big. It's time to find that out. Okay? Chapter 6 is about imagination, the mind's workshop. That's where everything started. Everything that you look out the window and everything you see started somewhere in the past in somebody's imagination. Everything. Every invention, the light bulb, the list is endless. So it's about imagination. Chapter 7 is about organized planning. You need to crystallize desire, but you have to have a plan. That's the financial plan that we're talking about on this show. That's Chapter 7. Chapter 8 is about overcoming procrastination. I'm going to do it tomorrow. I'm going to do it when I get around to it and all that kind of stuff. How to overcome procrastination. Chapter 9 is about persistence. Never, never give up. My stepson has a license plate. The license plate says never give up. just as a reminder, that's a cornerstone of success. Never give up. Thomas Edison tried 10,000 times to make a light bulb. Somebody once said, well, Mr. Edison, you must have been really discouraged. You tried 10,000 times to make a light bulb and failed. And he said, I didn't fail 10,000 times. He said, I discovered 10,000 ways not to make a light bulb. Okay? Beautiful words. Really, it's all there. Let's talk to Lynn from Mission. Lynn, welcome to the program. Hi, Lynn. Lynn's not there. Lynn, call back. Lynn is from Mission. She just called. She's gone right now. So, Lynn, give us a call back. So we're talking about your money, how to keep it. But how to keep it is all about wanting to keep it enough to take whatever steps are necessary to keep it. It means you can't spend 100% of everything you earn. Many of us spend 110% of what we earn and find ourselves massively in debt. Governments do the same thing. That's why we have these huge government deficits. In the United States, it's about $19 trillion right now. In Canada, it's over $1 trillion when you include the debt of all the provinces. That's public debt. It's huge. You can't spend more than you earn. And I say that if you do, it's because you don't have a plan. It's because you don't have a budget. And a budget is part of a financial plan. Okay? We talked about that over and over and over again. So, again, subconscious mind. We talked, chapter 13 is about the brain is a broadcasting and receiving mechanism. We actually communicate with other people by telepathy. And many, many people don't believe that. After reading the book, I believe it. We send out signals. It tells you how to turn them on. It tells you how to be able to read people. Chapter 14 is the sixth sense. You ever had that little man on your shoulder that says, maybe you shouldn't do it? Okay, we should be listening to that guy a little more often. Okay, the sixth sense. And chapter 15 is the big one, I think. It's the six ghosts of fear. The six basic fears. The things that we fear. It's fear that stops us from doing what we want to do. 604-280-0650. Long distance. 1-877-280-0650. Log on. www.cil650.com. And for those who are shy or reluctant to talk on the air, Frida's down at the office right now. Area code 604-737-3512, long distance 1-800-661-1495. You call the show, make sure you get a copy of the book, Think and Grow Rich, the real thing, not a download. If you already have the book, the workbook that accompanies that book. It's a workbook that you just fill in the blanks. It guides you all the way through, tells you how to achieve almost anything. I think the workbook is probably better than the book itself. Less effort to do the workbook, more participation to do the workbook. The book itself is not a difficult read, but there's 200 and some pages in that book. So it takes a fair amount of reading and a fair amount of effort. I think both represent time well spent. Okay. So you want to do better? Here's the question. How many people listening to this show right now? You're sitting there, nobody's watching you. Maybe you're listening to the radio. Put your hand up if you don't want to do better. Okay? Put your hand up if you don't want to do better. And believe you me, I can see you right now. Okay? That's communicating by way of the ether. Okay? I can see you. And a lot of you don't have your hands up, and I think you're lying. Okay? There isn't anybody anywhere that doesn't want to do better. Because the only way that you can't do better, really, is if you're perfect, and none of us are perfect. The show that I listened to on the way out here was exactly about that. How do you do better? How do you change? How do you evolve? Mankind is the only creature on this planet who was given a chance to participate in his own evolution. Okay? You can evolve. You can get better and better and better. When it comes to knowledge, it's called continuing education. Everything we know right now will be obsolete tomorrow. If we don't keep up, we're falling behind by default. That's a problem. Okay? So again, ladies and gentlemen, listeners out there, the number to call is area code 604-280-0650. Long distance, 1-877-280-0650. Log on www.cil650.com printed out the office. Area code 604-737-3512. Long distance, 1-800-661-1495. Joining me on the show today is Dr. Anne Marie Evers. She's an expert on the subject of motivation. And Dr. Anne Marie, I'd like to invite you to become part of my mastermind group. Would that be okay with you?
I'd love it. Yes, thank you.
Okay, I have a group of people. I have my own mastermind group. I got a top accountant. I got a top lawyer. I got in every field that you can imagine, and your field is going to be motivation. So when I want to talk, or I want information, or I need information on the subject of motivation, you're the person I turn to.
That's great. I am honored. Thank you so much.
Okay.
And I just wanted to say something about being specific, Fred. You know, if people do an affirmation, they have more money. If they get $1 more, they fulfilled that. So it's very important to be specific. And also when they're doing an affirmation for money, they need to specify net or gross, because it's a big difference, as you know, between the net figure and the gross figure.
Oh, for sure. Absolutely sure.
And also for Kathy, I was just thinking an affirmation I would do for her, if I were her, I would look in the mirror and say, I am becoming a patient person. I'm becoming more patient every day, and that would help her. And for Victoria, that get rid of the fear and worry, because I agree that, you know, worry is like a rocking chair. It gives you something to do, but gets you nowhere.
Absolutely. You know, a number of years ago, I have an in-law relative. I won't say how he is related, but he's something of a loser. And he's getting up in years, but every relationship that he's had ends up on the rocks. So he came to me one day and he said, can you help me? There's something wrong. I seem to lose my girlfriends all the time. What can I do to stop that? I gave him the book, Think and Grow Rich. I said, read this book. He read the book. At least he said he did. He got back to me and he said, you know something? That was a revelation. God, I wish I'd done that a long time ago. About 3 or 4 months went by, and he called me again with the poor me's. His name is Mike. So I said, Mike, read the book again. He said, I can't. I give it away. Like, that book is a source of incredible knowledge about how to be more successful. And everybody wants to be more successful. I've been on this planet for a lot of years, and I've read a lot of stuff and studied a lot of stuff and been involved in many courses, all kinds of influences that has affected my thinking and everything else. This book is far and greater than anything I've ever done when it comes to this particular topic. It's a fabulous book.
Well, I think the reason too is because it's information that's been tried and true and over the years since it's been written.
You know, It makes reference to the mastermind group in the book. Henry Ford apparently had something like 6 years of elementary school. That's all. And he became, at the time, this is in the 30s, the most successful businessman in the United States, save for maybe Andrew Carnegie. Okay? Very, very successful man. And the Chicago Tribune wrote an article condemning him for being uneducated. So he sued them. And in court, he was cross-examined. And they asked him all kinds of stupid questions like who discovered America and when and all that kind of stuff. So he wouldn't answer. He just sat there. And he listened for a while. And he finally stood up and he said, look, ladies and gentlemen, he said, I am not going to clutter my mind with useless knowledge. I'm going to use specialized knowledge about what I do, but useless knowledge is of no use to me. I'm not going to clutter my mind with it. That would be foolish. He said, on my desk, I have 15 buttons. One button says accountant. I need information on accounting. I push the button. My accountant comes in. I get the information. Another one says lawyer. I push that button. My lawyer comes in. I get the information. Another says engineers. I push that button. My engineers come in and I talk to them. That he called his mastermind group. And as I'm reading this, I'm saying to myself, God, that's Google today.
It certainly is.
It's Google.
Mm-hmm.
And today, it's not just a small group of people. It's all over the planet. You can link up to computers, hundreds of thousands of computers all over the planet, and share information. And some people say, well, the internet's, is, you know, there's a lot of garbage in there. Well, that may be true, but there's an awful lot of good stuff. So you got to learn how to read between the lines.
A lot of good information out there. Yeah.
Okay. Like, you have your own web page. That's on the internet.
Yes, and also, Fred,
I looked at it this morning.
I have another one. I've just completed it. It's called heretohelpsolutions.com. And on that, I have a lot of information. There's 26 videos, and they're short, 2 minutes or something, that people can go and get a lot of information, Fred, on everything. So I would sure be happy to
have
them visit.
Give us your web address for our listeners' sake right now.
The website?
Yes.
Is here to help, H-E-R-E, to help, solutions, with an S, .com.
And if you've missed that, you can call myself or Frida to get that, and we'll pass it along to you.
Yes, and I wanted to say, any of your listeners listening, Fred, that have problems that need help with affirmations, I do have an email that I'd be happy to listen to help them with affirmations. But they just need to put Fred Snyder at the top, because they get so many emails, I'll know where they came from then. And
yeah.
My email address, if they want to do that, if it's okay with you.
That's fine with me.
It's
sure.
Simply annmarieevers@shaw.ca. And that's annmarie, and then another E, evers@shaw.ca.
Okay, so, ladies and gentlemen, listeners out there, you want to do better? You want to do better than you're doing right now? You have to want to. So I have the 6 steps to kindle desire that I'm going to just review. And there, again, they're in the book. You want a copy of it? Get the book. Read the chapter on desire. But I'll shortcut that right now, and we'll talk about the 6 steps. I put a pistol there. That's a 6-shooter, just as an icon to remember the 6 steps. The first step is be definite as to the amount. We're talking, in this case, about money. There is a psychological reason for definiteness, which will be described in subsequent chapters. Second step. Determine exactly what you intend to give in return for the money you desire.
Very important.
It's not free. There is no such reality as something for nothing. Now, it may not be money that you give in return, but it might be effort. It might be time. But determine exactly what you intend to give up in return for the money that you desire. Step 3. Establish a definite date when you intend to possess the money you desire. And not necessarily, it can be anything else too. It can be losing 20 pounds, as an example. Create a definite plan. God, how often do we talk about the plan? Create a definite plan for carrying out your desire and begin at once, whether you're ready or not, to put the plan into action. A plan is in writing. Number 5, write out a clear, concise statement of the amount of money you intend to acquire. Name the time limit for its acquisition, state what you intend to give up in return for the money, and describe clearly the plan through which you intend to accumulate it. And the last step, 6, read your written statement aloud twice every day, once just before retiring at night and once after arising in the morning. As you read, see and feel and believe yourself already in possession of the money. Think and grow rich.
Yep. And act as if you already have it.
Yeah.
And the plan is is the affirmation. And I suggest they read it twice in the morning. Read it once in the morning and once in the evening. And then I suggest they step ahead whatever they want, some weeks or months.
And what are you doing when you're reading this plan? What are you really doing? It's almost a form of affirmation as well. You're programming your subconscious mind.
You are. And allow those words to sink deep into your subconscious mind, where they take root, grow, and become. And then I suggest that they bring in the 5 physical senses, and where they hear, see, hear, smell, taste, and whatever else it is, the 5 physical senses.
Yeah.
And they do that and then put their affirmation away and take it out in the evening and do the same thing. And then during the day, they can do a short-form affirmation.
You get this affirmation into your subconscious mind. You're on autopilot after that.
Exactly. Yes,
okay? Let's take some calls. Let's talk to Gene from Parksville. Gene, welcome to the program. Hi, Jane.
Yes, hello.
Hi, Jane. You're on the air.
Okay.
What's your question?
I was just listening to your program, and this is going to be one of my, I don't know what year it's called, but I'll be turning 58, and I was born in 1958.
Yes.
And I lost both of my parents at a young age of 5, and I still keep using different tools for growing.
Yes.
And I think that would, your book would be helpful on that.
Yeah. Okay. Well, we'll see you get a copy of the book. How's that?
Yeah, that's great.
Okay. And I can't tell you how much I appreciate your call. You take care. Enjoy
the
rest of the weekend. Let's talk to Yvette from Nanaimo. Yvette, welcome to the program.
Welcome. And hi to your guest.
Yeah.
My question to you is, when David Ingram was alive, he was saying that he didn't want to buy RSPs. And when he did, he says it was close to when he was 65. So clarify something. He was saying that so he can take the money out. When you hit 65,
The pension income exemption is what you're talking about.
Pardon?
The pension income exemption is what you're talking about.
I don't know what that's
At the time, you could have $1,000 of pension income tax-free. Today, I believe, it's $2,000.
So you're saying pension, you're not...
It's called the pension income exemption. You convert your RSP to a RIF at age 65, it's considered to be a pension. It won't work before age 65, but if you were to convert enough of your RSP at age 65 to generate an income of $2,000 a year, that would be tax-free.
Oh, so you have to convert it. Okay.
Oh, yeah. And actually, he said he'll never buy an RSP, but he bought the RSP for me in order to facilitate that.
Yeah, in order to do that. Okay, so I misunderstood. Okay, I'm going to clarify that with somebody then, because I was telling an older couple about that, and so I better make sure I know the facts.
There's a line on your I don't know what line number it is, but there's a line on your tax return that says pension income exemption. I have an accountant out there that would like to clarify that. Get on the line and give us a call. Okay?
Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay, Yvette, appreciate your call. Enjoy the rest of the weekend. Okay, we have to go to the break. And again, we're talking about that very inspirational topic. Always gets me very, very excited. Motivation. Don't go away.
So you got to start thinking about how you're spending your money.
Fred Snyder.
If you can reduce the amount of tax you pay, that means that you get a tax refund. So you get a tax refund means you've really overpaid your taxes. And if you overpay your taxes, what you've really done is loan money to the government. So rule number one of my 46 ways to ease the tax bite is don't lend your money to the government.
Fred Snyder.
So pay your taxes. We're not talking about not paying your taxes. We're talking about legal ways to reduce the taxes you pay. Not avoid them, to reduce the taxes you pay so that you can have more money to save and invest, so that you can achieve your financial goals sooner. And if you're already there, stay there longer. Because once you get there, it's your obligation to stay there.
Fred Snyder.
If you have a financial plan and you're somewhere in the middle and you're wondering what tweaks that you should make in that plan to make it what you really want it to be, time to make a phone call. Or if maybe you're just getting started out and you want to get a starter plan, maybe it's time to talk to somebody like myself and get yourself on the right track.
Fred Snyder.
I think that everybody needs to go and make an appointment to see Fred.
Talk to Fred. Listen to Fred. Fred Snyder. Sunday mornings 9 to 11 on CIO 650. Welcome back to It's Your Money on CIO 650. If you have a question for Fred, call 604-280-0650. Now back to Fred.
Okay, we're back. Remind you once again, ladies and gentlemen, we're live. We're talking with Dr. Anne Marie Evers, who's an expert on the subject of motivation and a member of my mastermind group. So when I want expert advice or expert knowledge or information regarding the subject of motivation, I talk to her. We've been talking about your subconscious mind. Let's graduate. Let's switch to the area of infinite intelligence. Infinite intelligence. The invariable mark of wisdom is to see the miraculous in the common. Those are the words of Ralph Waldo Emerson. It's infinite. There's no boundaries at all. Infinite intelligence. The internet, just as an example. through a method of procedure unknown to man. It's unknown to man. The unconscious mind draws upon the forces of infinite intelligence for the power with which it voluntarily transmutes one's desires into their physical equivalent, such as money, making use always of the most practical media by which this end must be accomplished. Dr. Evers, what does that mean to you?
Well, it means that there's unlimited possibilities. And I look at it this way, that when we started the show, it was in the present, and it slipped into the past, and now we have the present and the future, which is full of possibilities, opportunities, and infinite opportunities. We can, you know, the power is so great if we only knew, like you say, how to use it and would use it. Now, it takes effort, too. You can't just say, oh, I'm going to use it. Not. You need to use it.
Well, there's techniques for using it, like closing your eyes. I mentioned it earlier.
Yeah, just I
as
do
an
that
example.
All the time when I
it
do
says,
my affirmation.
It says that every brain on this planet is hooked up together, just like the Internet.
Yes, we are. Yeah, okay. We're all part of the same.
I don't know if I completely believe that or not, but I'm open-minded about it.
I do. I believe
and,
that.
And really, I mean, think about this, if you will. Think about the light bulb, just as an example. Let's pretend that let's just go back in time to a time when there was no such thing as electricity or light bulbs. And then if you went back there, could you create a light bulb? Could you build one?
Even though
you know it exists? Think about the fact that Edison tried 10,000 times to make a light bulb and failed.
Yeah, I know. That is incredible.
Think about inventing a light bulb. I'm told that came to Edison in his sleep.
Yeah, I heard that too. Yeah.
Okay. He finally figured it out. How many people listening to the show right now really know how a light bulb works? You see, what's inside the light bulb? It's a vacuum. There's no air. Therefore, the filament can't burn, because to burn it needs oxygen. There's no air. It's a vacuum. So the electricity passes through the filament, which creates resistance in that wire, which heats it up to red hot. That creates the light.
I didn't know that. That's interesting.
That's chemistry.
Wow.
I was an honor student when I went to school on that subject.
It sounds like you were.
Yeah. But think about imagining that.
Yeah.
You know, you got to say, wouldn't it be nice if we could all get, I watched a show the other day on whaling, and it's an offshoot of the movie Moby Dick.
Oh, yes.
But they go out and they kill these whales to get the oil. They burned the oil to create light in those days. That's what they did. Well, just imagine you're an inventor and you're back there, and wouldn't it be nice if I could invent something that would create this light? Let's see, to do that, how? Like, what ingredients do I need? I need electricity. I don't think you would even dream of that.
No, you wouldn't.
You'd be turning lightning into electricity.
Yeah.
How do you create electricity? What is it? We don't even know.
It's true.
So imagine inventing a light bulb. I think it's almost impossible. That man had to be a brilliant man. But he drew on the area of infinite intelligence.
He did,
according
exactly.
to the book. Okay.
Beyond his human capability.
Had to be.
Yeah.
Where would the world be today without light bulbs and electricity and all the rest of that kind of stuff? You cannot entirely control your subconscious mind, but you can voluntarily hand over to it any plan, desire, or purpose which you wish transformed into concrete form.
Exactly.
So turn it over to your, you want to be wealthy, turn it over to your subconscious mind.
And then do the work, though, too.
Yeah. But in order to turn it over to your subconscious mind, that's the subject of this show.
Yes.
It's called affirmations.
It certainly is. And the affirmations is the work. And you can do affirmations, but you need to, like, you could stand in an elevator all day and affirm it moves to the third floor, but until somebody takes action and pushes the button, nothing happens.
Beautiful analogy.
And affirmations really need to be, you blow breath into it. If you're doing an affirmation for money, you get out there, you search the internet, you talk to you folks and about prosperity and saving your money and plans. You talk to Fred Snyder, and if you're looking for help with affirmations, you talk to me. And that's the way it is. You find people that know what they're doing in their area, and then you learn from them, and then because no one knows everything about everything.
or read the book, and go to the chapter on the subconscious mind and read the chapter on auto-suggestion.
Yes.
There's a chapter on that particular topic.
Yeah, and, you know, like one time I was a witness in a court case, and this lady said that this man said that he could heal her, and the other people were suing because he didn't happen. And so I was called up on the stand, and the judge said to me, "Do you believe that in the healing power?" And I said, "Yes, I do." And he said, "Well, you can't see it." And I said, "No, you can't, Your Honor, but I can't see electricity, but I must believe in it because I pay my electric bill every month."
Yeah, for sure.
And the guy won the case, you know, because it was right. Because the thing is, you know, and belief comes in too. You know, Fred, faith. It's so important to have faith. And how I do my faith things is I have books of all my completed affirmations that have happened, and a big check mark in the date they happen. And then when I go to do another one, I simply look at my books and I think, oh my goodness, how dare I doubt? Look at all the affirmations that came true that I did. Even ones I didn't quite believe would come true did.
Yeah. There is plenty of evidence to support the belief that the subconscious mind is the connecting link between the finite mind of man and infinite intelligence.
Exactly.
Okay. And if you're going to really achieve beyond your potential, or at least your potential, you have to be connected to infinite intelligence one way or another. It's out there. It's like using the internet. I think it's a terrific analogy. Every mind on this planet is linked, just like the internet links all these computers that are all over the globe right now. So if you can tap into that intelligence, the world is your oyster. Lots of calls coming in right now. Let's talk to Mavis from Vancouver. Mavis, welcome to the program.
Hello?
Hi, Mavis.
No, it's Maria.
Oh, Maria, hi.
Hi, how are you?
Oh, pretty good. How are you?
I'm good. I just want to say something to the first two ladies that spoke, and I want to tell them to never give up and to stay positive. Also, they need to believe in the power of food. If we stop eating food that's been processed and loaded with sugar, and we turn ourselves to fruit and vegetables, basic dairy and meat, we have a better chance of keeping our body healthy and helping our body to heal. So we shouldn't forget that. If you look at the size of supermarkets, they're becoming bigger and bigger every day.
And more sugar.
Right? And you know, I was watching the news, and they were saying that just about everything has sugar. So
I think we watched the same program. Was that Dr. Gupta on CNN?
I believe. No, I think I was watching either Dr. Oz or
well,
Dr.
he did
him. Anyways,
he did a show yesterday,
but
and it was on sugar.
I need to say this because I couldn't believe it, and it's going to be out of my diet for the rest of my life. I was going to have hot dogs, so I thought, gee, why don't
processed.
I get to go and check the package? Surely there's no sugar in the hot dog. Well, there it was, sugar. And I thought to myself, this is really, really pathetic. We can't even eat a piece of meat without sugar in it.
If it's been processed, you don't eat it. That's my rule.
Yes, and this is why I decided to call in to tell people that we need to go back to basics to 100 years ago,
sure,
where everything was prepared in the kitchen daily. Once in a while, yes, we do need that processed food because we don't have time. But if we don't make time for our body, we are going to be just like a car. If a car doesn't have the best gasoline, the best oil, it doesn't run at top speed.
You're right on. Bang on.
So I just want to tell the people to beware, because what is the point of making all that money and buying that mansion if your body gives up on you because you didn't take the time?
Health and wealth, they go together.
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
And
the best way to
you,
stay healthy is don't eat processed foods.
Yes. And we should put a lot of companies out of business because they're not doing us any service.
Yeah. Gotcha. Maria, can't tell you how much I appreciate your call. Enjoy
thank
the rest
so
of the weekend.
Thank
Take care.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye for now. Let's talk to Mavis. Mavis, this time from Vancouver. Mavis, welcome to the program.
Yes, good morning.
Good morning.
This is about the pension income you mentioned earlier on, about
yes.
the $2,000 from
yeah.
the roof.
Mm-hmm.
But if one do not have a roof, how does one claim it?
If one does not have what?
RIF.
A RIF?
Yes. Where do you claim
well,
it
from? Mavis, do you have an RRSP?
No, I do, but I mean, I'm talking with somebody that hasn't got a RIF.
Does that person have an RRSP?
No, he doesn't have an RRSP.
There's no way to claim it unless he has pension income. If you don't have pension income, you have to create pension income. You can create pension income, it comes under that definition, by creating a RIF.
So
you create a RIF by having an RRSP. Now, if a person is out there, if they can make an RRSP contribution and they don't have one, they make an RRSP contribution so that they have one, then they convert it to a RIF.
So if one buy annuity, that's a pension income, right?
It's not. No, it's not necessarily considered pension income. It could be, but it's not necessarily.
Oh, so the only way...
Just buying an annuity isn't going to create pension income.
Oh, I see. So you have to be a RIF.
It has to be a form of income. It has to be a vehicle which qualifies as a pension. You have to have pension income, and you can take advantage of that exemption if you have pension income. If you don't have it, sometimes you can create it. If you're under 65, it doesn't work. You got to be 65 or older.
No, it's over 65. Somebody.
You got to be over 65.
Yeah, 65.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
So the only way you can claim it is from a RIF, then.
That's correct.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
Okay.
Do I get a book from?
Call Frieda. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. Take care.
Thank you. Bye bye.
Bye bye. Okay, let's talk to Arnold from Vancouver. Arnold, welcome to the program.
Yeah. Hi. Good morning.
This good morning, Arnold.
Yeah. Fred, the reason I'm calling you, I'm a listener for your good radio show for quite some time, for a long time actually,
mm-hmm.
and I'm quite impressed about it. I'm a retired businessman all my life,
mm-hmm.
and we have been very successful. We have coming from Germany originally, immigrated in 81, become a Canadian citizen. I never missed any vote, whether civil, provincial, or federally, this is for me a must, a given. And we live pretty much financially in a way, actually, what you are preaching. And life was good to us. And what I like now, it is actually get this book and read it myself. And especially for a main reason to pass it on to my kids and grown-up grandchildren.
Absolutely perfect. The best thing any parent can do is make sure your children share in the philosophy that I'm talking about right now. I've been a businessman for 50 years now, and this book has been my Bible.
Making money and keeping it, this is the philosophy, actually, this is the ground rule in life, in a meaningful, successful life, and this is what we did all along. I tell you one thing, Fred, we have had credit cards, not many, just maybe three or four. Now we have it down by two. Which is with the TD and the other is the Costco, and mm-hmm. that's what we still do. Having a credit card and pay, we never paid in our life one penny of interest on a credit card. Never, always paid in full.
That's a plan. That's an affirmation.
And
never will I pay any interest. That's an affirmation.
Yes, it is.
Okay, so Arnold, what advice would you give our listeners? Don't pay interest?
Yeah.
Okay?
Never.
That's a great affirmation. I will never pay interest on anything.
No, the only interest we paid it is just on a mortgage,
yeah.
on a property, and the property has to have from the beginning a positive cash flow. Just from the start, so with a healthy down payment or so, whatever, and we made the financial plan for it, and I made my own calculation with my wife. My wife mm-hmm. was a great, great business lady, I said was, because I'm 78 now, and mm-hmm. I lost my wife last Christmas. Mm-hmm. And she was an enorm, smart, intelligent woman, and I never had to be worried about it. She was the best secretary for me. the mm-hmm. best accountant, the best money keeper, and we talked about.
And you would consider yourself to be a very successful person, I can tell. But listen to me, when I say this, right in the book, it said one of the keys to success is to marry the right woman.
Exactly. Yeah. No, you know what?
Bingo.
No, right. We started both from the scratch. I can say I married up because I know this is a lady I can have success. And we had. It was my sense of a thing. So I fell in love we have been together since 1957. And I had a great life, but I lost my wife on Christmas, and it was a very tragic situation, you know, on a incurable illness with COPD and an oxygen. But she was a woman, smart and a never give up lady on anything, and especially when it comes to a healthy living and positive thinking, and it kept her and kept both of us going.
Arnold, do you have the book Think and Grow Rich?
Pardon me?
Do you have the book Think and Grow Rich?
Yeah, no, this is what I like, to have the book.
Well, that's what I say. So you get the book. All you got to do is call Frida.
Call Frida, yeah. 737-3512.
You got it.
Okay. So, yeah, I'll do that. So, anyway, I did already, and then the lady from... Scotia McGowdy said, okay, I have to call you first. And this is what I just did to be on the radio.
Well, bingo. Thanks for your call. Really appreciate it. Enjoy the rest of the weekend.
Okay, good.
Bye-bye. Okay, Arnold, great words of wisdom there. Really, really appreciate that. And anybody who calls the show, I can't tell you how much I appreciate those calls. Get in the line. Give us a call. Get a copy of the book. If you already have the book, we'll give you the workbook instead. Okay. Because I think what we're talking about here today is critical. Critical to your future financial success. Someone once said, if you want to predict the future, create it today. This is how to do it. The simplest thing that you can do to create your future today is to make a phone call. Start the process. That's the button you push when you get in the car to start the engine up. Okay? Make a phone call. Easy call, 604-280-0650. Long distance, 1-877-280-0650. Log on, www.cil650.com. And for those who are shy or reluctant to talk on the air for any reason whatsoever, Frida's down at the office, area code 604-737-3512. If you're calling long distance, it's a free call, incidentally. It's 1-800-661-1495. Just tuned in. I'm certified financial planner Fred Snyder. Got a stamp on my back just to prove it. I'm also a registered financial planner representing Scotia Wealth Management. It used to be Scotia McLeod. We changed the name because it more aptly describes what we do. And some people say, well, what do you do? Well, my raison d'etre, my reason for being, my mission is to teach people what they need to know to make better financial decisions so that they can become financially independent sooner and stay financially independent longer. So let's extract from that two things. Financially independent sooner. That connotes that that can help you get there quicker. Or if you're already there, stay there longer. And half the people, when we talked about those 100 people, half the people who are financially independent at age 65 are financially dependent again by age 70 because they didn't deal with taxes and inflation. Okay? You start looking at it, you know, I meant to bring one in, and I'm going to use it on my next show, but I have a little booklet that my wife picked up about what happened in 1935. That was the year I was born. Okay? Incredible. I'm going to start giving those away on this show. Okay? Just you phone in, you tell me what year you were born, I can tell you what happened in that year. Okay? Incredible. And it's interesting. Because in there's a price list as to what you paid for a pound of sugar, a loaf of bread. This is nice. And what the you know what the unemployment rate was in 1935? It was 20%. You know what the life expectancy in 1935 that's the year I was born, incidentally. I was supposed to die by the time I was 60. Well, I'm still around. Okay? I mean, how things have changed. And if we don't evolve as people, if we don't evolve, if we don't grow and develop, we don't keep up. So that's called continuing education, or it's called growth and development, whatever you want to call it. And I started the show by saying that having is the result of being. You have to become before you can have. So don't just say to me, well, I want a new car, and expect somebody to hand it over to you. Or I want a bigger house. Become the kind of a person that deserves a bigger house. Become the kind of a person that deserves a Ferrari or some kind of a fancy car like that. Become the kind of person who is socially accepted into the most exclusive clubs in town, who has a trust fund for the kids. Become that kind of person, and you will attract that which you desire. Don't get the cart before the horse. If I wrote lots of people listening to the show, if I wrote many people listening to the show a check for $1 million, it wouldn't take you long before that $1 million would be gone. Statistics prove it. Those who win lotteries end up devastating. Because the first thing they do, they pay off their mother's mortgage, they buy their brother a fancy house, and so on and so forth. That's like going into the apple orchard and to get the apples, but you cut the trees down to get the apples. You'd only want to spend the earnings that you accumulate from the money that you have. You don't spend the principal. And incidentally, if you're spending more than you earn on your lifestyle, the deficit comes from your principal. And if you don't have no principal, then you must borrow, and that's debt. So it's either debt or capital, one or the other. The best way to become wealthy is to spend less than you earn. And if you do that, your bank account gets bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. And someday you're going to have too much money in the bank. And then you got to talk to somebody like myself to say, what do I do with all this extra money that I have sitting in the bank making me nothing? Because if you get 2% from a bank account, which may be hard these days unless you lock it in, but if you get 2% from a bank account after taxes and inflation, your real return is probably negative. If 2% is taxable, you keep 1 after taxes, if you're in the top tax bracket. And if inflation is 3, your return is now negative. Let's talk to Lillianne from Vancouver. Lillianne, welcome to the program.
Yes, good morning. I guess I better turn the radio off here so I don't get backlash.
Okay.
I listen every Sunday morning, actually, going to church to your program, and the words of wisdom. For me, it would be really important that the younger people listen to this. I mean, I'm older now. I'm 69.
Do you have any children?
Pardon me?
Do you have any children?
Yes, I have a daughter who's 27.
Get the book and give it to her. You get the book, so we'll make sure you get the book. Give it to your daughter.
Oh, that's a good idea, because she doesn't want to call in. She, you know, blah, 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 all the rest.
I understand, sure.
And even for me, like, I try to give her my life experience, you know, going to university, becoming a nurse, becoming a teacher. And I told her, I said, you know, with the crisis we had back a number of years ago with you, I had money saved for your education. I had money saved for my retirement. Guess what happened? I had to pay medical bills for you. We had to leave Vancouver.
Sure.
Guess what? We were wiped out within 5 years. So there's nothing for me left. I'm 69. Uh-huh. Made the plans, and there's nothing left for you now either. So plan now, please.
The plan's the thing.
You know, and that's it. It's trying to get it through her head, but it just, you know, maybe with the book, I don't know.
The Investors Group, one of the largest financial planning organizations in the country, I used to work for those guys years ago, but they have what they call the plan. And with reverence, it's always in big, bold, capital letters, the plan.
Yeah.
The plan is it. The plan's the thing. Okay.
Well, the plan, and then I don't know what the other word would be. Plan, and I don't know. Extend
planning.
The plan. Extend it.
Listen, I have what I refer to as my three P's. The first P stands for plan. The second P stands for planning, which is the process. The last P stands for product. So everybody needs a plan. Everybody needs a planner. They need some kind of a process for developing the plan and working the plan. And then they need the right products inside the plan. Too many people think the products are the plan. That's not the case. Okay? Well, that so you got to have three things, plan, three Ps, plan, planning, and product.
Yeah. And that was a mistake, too, that I should pass on to listeners. When you're planning and you have someone planning and helping you, like an accountant, which I did, I just left everything in his hands, and I didn't even, well, very rarely contacted him. He never contacted me. So actually, when, what was it, 80, when did we have that crisis thing?
87?
87.
Which one do you want to talk about? Because we've had lots of them. 87, 1990, tech bubble crash.
Yeah, maybe it was 1990. I don't know. Anyways, you know, I contacted him. He says, oh, all of a sudden, you know, you don't have this. And I thought, oh, what the hell? You didn't contact me. Why didn't you? Anyways, keep on top of whoever's
planning. Lillian, you know, there's an old saying, and it goes like this. It didn't get done. You thought I was doing it. I thought you were doing it, and nobody was doing it.
Yeah.
That's why you have to communicate. You have to be able to talk to your financial expert. Because if you can't talk to your financial expert, this is what happens. Exactly. It didn't get done. You thought I was doing it. I thought you were doing it. Nobody was doing it.
Yeah, for me it was, oh, I hate paperwork. I don't want to work with numbers, blah, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. Just let him look after it. Yeah, right, okay. That was a big mistake. So again, to listeners, besides the planning and having the planner and all of this, you know, really follow through with whom you are, you know, investing and making sure that you're up to date. You know what's happening. Also,
Lillian, I can't tell you how much I appreciate your call. We have to move along. Yep. It's break time. We got to go to the break.
Have a great day.
Okay, you too. Bye-bye. Okay, when we come back, we're going to graduate from infinite intelligence to creativity. This is about how you talk to infinite intelligence. So we're going to tell you how to communicate with infinite intelligence. Don't go away.
Fred Snyder.
I want you to imagine a person who is uptight, always worried, has high blood pressure, looking at their bank statement every time they turn around, and it's always red, okay? They're spending more than they earn. They can't seem to get out of the hole. They're always telling people, I'm catching up, I'm trying to catch up, so they're always behind the eight ball. And life isn't pretty, and they're not happy, and they're frustrated. And they're not even fun to be around, those kind of people. There's a black cloud hanging over their head. Visualize that, because there's lots of people out there right now that are in that boat.
Fred Snyder.
And you have to ask yourself the question right now, what would happen if that happened to me? Because here I am. I'm sitting out here. I don't have a written financial plan. I haven't taken the time to sit down and think about my goals, the things that I really want to accomplish. I'm like a ship without a rudder. I have no direction. I'm procrastinating because I don't know what to do. And I'm still not doing anything about it. So instead of being proactive as I should be, I'm being reactive. I'm waiting for the bad stuff to happen and not controlling my destiny. If that's you, it's time to make a phone call.
Call Fred. Talk to Fred. Listen to Fred. Fred Snyder. Sunday mornings 9 to 11 on CIL 650. This is CISL Vancouver. Smooth and easy. You're listening to It's Your Money on CIL 650. Once again, here is Fred Snyder.
Hey, we're back and we're live, and we got about a half an hour before we have to go. And we're encouraging you to give us a phone call. All callers will receive the book, Think and Grow Rich, or the workbook that accompanies it. Simply takes a phone call. Might be the most important step that you ever take to make that phone call. I'm talking with Dr. Marie Evers, Marie Ann Evers, who's an expert on the subject of motivation. And we're talking about the greatest book that was ever written on that subject, and it's called Think and Grow Rich. It was the precursor to all the modern motivational speakers, because their ideas all originated from this book. And I'm including Zig Ziglar, Brian Tracy, the list is endless, people that talk about the word motivation. I have one of those people on the line right now, Dr. Evers, so welcome back.
Thank you very much.
Okay, and we're now going to talk about how to talk to the infinite intelligence that we just talked about. What is the link? The possibilities of creative effort connected with the subconscious mind are stupendous and imponderable. They inspire one with awe. I never approach the discussion of the subconscious mind without a feeling of littleness and inferiority, due perhaps to the fact that man's entire stock of knowledge on this subject is so pitiful, pitifully limited. We don't know much about this. The very fact that the subconscious mind is the medium of communication between the thinking mind of man and infinite intelligence is of itself a thought which almost paralyzes one's reason. It takes a stretch to believe this stuff, ladies and gentlemen, okay? It's not natural. After you have accepted as a reality the existence of the subconscious mind and understand its possibilities as a medium for transmuting your desires into their physical or monetary equivalent, you will comprehend the full significance of the instructions given on the chapter on desire. See how these chapters are interlinked? Okay? You got to get the book. You got to read the chapter on desire. And again, it talks about a burning desire. You got to be spellbound. You got to want something so badly that you're obsessed. If you're obsessed about the accumulation of money, how can you possibly fail if you're obsessed about it? Okay? You know darn well you can't spend 100% of what you earn and accumulate money. You know that. We all know that. You can't spend more than you earn and stay out of debt. We all know that. Yet what do? We do it anyway. And we know better. Why do we do it? Because of our bloody subconscious mind. Somehow or another, these little gremlins creep in there and we let them in. We got to guard against that. And you have to learn to program your subconscious mind. That's what this book is all about. That's what we're talking about. You want to do better? Change your subconscious mind. Do a weed job. Get the weeds out of your subconscious mind. Replace them. How do you do that? The word is affirmations, as Dr. Evers speaks. She talks about affirmations so that you can reprogram your subconscious mind. So on this creativity, talking to infinite intelligence, Dr. Evers, what does that mean to you?
Well, it means exactly to get your to want something and be so excited about something that like you're just obsessed or filled with that.
Can you hear the excitement and enthusiasm in my voice today?
Yes, of course I can. Yes, yeah. And I get so excited.
I'm just pretending.
I just can't wait to tell people about affirmations and how they work and motivation and all these things. And I truly believe in the book you're promoting because it is the basis of all. And I think all the writers, myself included, we've taken from that and we've learned from that and we've tried it. And you know what's so exciting, Fred, is when you use these processes and they work, that makes you more excited than ever because then you're going on to the next one and the next one. And then when you tell other people about it, your excitement shines through and it gets them excited through the law of attraction.
And that's covered in the book as well. So the book says that if you want to be enthusiastic, act enthusiastic.
Exactly.
I was kidding when I said that because I really am enthusiastic.
Fake it.
But
till
it
you
says
make
if
it,
you pretend you are, you will. You said fake it till you make it. It's right on.
Yeah. Okay?
You want to be happy? Pretend you're happy.
Yeah.
So if you know in the 10 scrolls from the greatest salesman that we talk about on this show sometimes.
Yeah.
There's 10 scrolls and one of the scrolls says that I will master my emotions. That's how you do it.
Yep.
You fake it till you make it.
Yeah, you sure do.
Yes. You know, there's six positive emotions that are identified and six negative ones. Do you know them?
Well, I do, but remind me of them.
I don't have them at my fingertips, so
yeah,
I won't remember them all anyway. But sad, happy, you know.
Yeah, they're all common sense ones.
I mean, they're all there.
Yeah.
I have some icons which show facial expressions.
Yeah.
So you can look at a person's face and you can tell how they're feeling at any particular time.
Yeah, you could look at just the energy around them too.
And decisions, you know, every decision you make is usually based on emotion, not logic.
It's so true.
Okay.
Unless you really set your mind to this is a logical decision and you think about it, otherwise every decision is made on how you feel. I feel I want to eat. You eat. I feel I want to go here or talk to this person, and that's so true.
Well, I mean, if you think about it logically, why would anybody spend $300,000 or $400,000 on a car?
Yeah.
Think about it.
I know somebody.
I mean, a car is to get you from point A to point B.
That's exactly my thoughts on a car, a vehicle.
I can buy a $15,000 car that will get me from point A to point B, or I can spend maybe $400,000 or $500,000. Is that a logical decision?
I don't think so. It depends on the person that's making it. I know a man that made that decision because he's suffering from a certain illness, and he has money, and he thinks that I'm going to spend it on what I want. So it's a mindset too.
Sure. But again, decisions, especially big decisions, are always made emotionally. So if you're going to make decisions involving yourself, involving reprogramming your subconscious mind or whatever, you have to make those decisions at the subconscious level.
Yes.
And the only way you can talk to your subconscious mind is by using affirmations.
Exactly. That is the language. It is the language of the subconscious mind knows.
So what was the famous affirmation of Cassius Clay, or Muhammad Ali, as he's now known?
I
am the greatest.
I am the greatest.
Before every fight, he would look in the mirror and put his arms up in the air and say, I am the greatest.
And even the I am is great, but he put the greatest after it, which made it even more powerful. Mm-hmm. Isn't that interesting? Now, Fred, I wanted to ask you a question. You know, there's such a thing as balance, too, isn't there? Now, people can save for retirement, and they can save every penny and not enjoy the present, what we're going through. And then when it's all over, they have a whole bunch of money.
And they can't take it with them.
Yeah. So you know what? Have you ever seen a U-Haul behind a hearse?
I have an icon in my workshop on estate planning. And the title says you can't take it with you, and it has a hearse with a U-Haul behind it.
You've seen it, then. You're the one person that I asked that said that. Most people say no.
I dreamt that one up. I had to think of an icon to remember you can't take it with you. That's the icon.
Exactly so. And so I guess my advice for people would be, too, to live in the present and not, you know, so many people say, oh, I made a mistake. I did this back then. Why didn't I invest in Whistler in 1974? Why didn't I do this? Why didn't I do that? But you need to stop beating ourselves up for what we didn't do and start working on the things we are doing. And people think they fail, but you talked about failure before, about the light bulb, but failure according to who? Failure according to what? And I believe I take what my so-called failures and use them as extraordinary fertilizers for my many successes.
It's like Edison when he said 10,000 ways to make a light bulb. I didn't fail 10,000 times. I learned 10,000 ways not to make a light bulb.
Yeah, and there it applies. Failure according to who?
That's
not
correct.
To him. He wasn't failure, but the other people thought he was.
Who's measuring?
Yeah, that's it. And so why do people get hung up on the shoulda, coulda, woulda, why didn't I? And they should themselves to death. Why? Why not enjoy the present? And I really agree with what you're saying. Take thought for tomorrow. Have it ready. I mean, plan for tomorrow. Plan is one of the greatest things. But then use your common sense, too, and just don't focus on just having a whole bunch of money, but focus on having money and also living your life as you live each and every day.
Someone once said, yesterday is a canceled check.
Yeah, today.
Tomorrow's a promissory note. Only today is money in the bank.
Exactly so. I've heard that too. Yeah. And,
okay. Let's talk to Guy from Vancouver. Guy, welcome to the program.
Oh, hi, Fred. Thank you.
Hi, Guy.
I've heard you over the years, and there is one matter that I never see covered where people undertake a venture, almost all of them do, and they lose 50% of their assets, and the probability of that happening is 50%. And you would never advise a client to invest in something where there was a 50% probability that they lose 50% of their assets.
No.
And it happens all the time, and that's one area. Last time I tried discussing this matter, David Ingram was one of your guests. And basically, it is marriage. The reason it has become more important to me lately is because of my son. He made about $1 million with his own earnings.
Mm-hmm.
He's in his early 30s, and he got $1 million because his mother passed away about a year ago. Now, I was trying to advise him that there's a pretty good chance that he'll lose most of it. He works very hard, spends very little. He's in California, an IT engineer. And I thought of your program just to sort of mention it to you that this is one area, and David Ingram shied away from this matter. He said you just have to pay attention to your personal life and so on. Normally, or quite often, that doesn't work because there's an incentive to break up that venture. I give an example to my son. If you were running a business and you went out with your bookkeeper and she or he became entitled to 50% of that business, how long do you think the business will last?
Well, that's a good question. Wonderful question.
And this was just a suggestion. It's
that's like putting
possible.
The fox in charge of the hen house.
Pardon me?
That's like putting the fox in charge of the hen house.
No, the bookkeeper part was not the important part.
No. Mm-hmm.
It was the contribution to the business. The owner may have spent long hours trying to build up the business. The bookkeeper may have put in very little effort. But if that bookkeeper can see that by breaking up that business, they become entitled to 50% of the value of the business, there is always an incentive to destroy that business.
Sure, there's no question about it.
No, it was not the bookkeeper part.
Yeah.
The person could have been in another role.
Sure.
It doesn't matter. I wasn't talking about the ability to access the business records as a bookkeeper. No, that was not the... It was the contribution to the business. And it's always the person who works harder that loses in these ventures. And I may contact you in the near future at your office telephone number to discuss it, because there are some ways the venture can be benefit from some pre-planning. I would suggest that to my son. He's doing fine. He himself does not need much help. He relies on industry-specific ETFs, and then he supplements the proceedings with the writing options. So he's doing fine. His return has been close to 14% or so. I was amazed. ETFs are only doing 10% between 1984. He's in the United States, so I'm using the United
sure,
States.
Sure, I understand. Yeah.
But anyway, this was just a suggestion. This area gets ignored completely. Everyone will benefit from it. I have not seen anyone pay any attention to it, and this was just a request.
Well, I appreciate that.
Okay.
I'll try to address that particular issue. Can't tell you how much I appreciate your call.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, you take care, guy. Okay, I got Danny from Burnaby on the line. Danny, welcome to the program.
Yeah, hi, Fred. You know, I'm just kind of wondering. I mean, I don't know... too many people today who are doing all that well as far as in their portfolios because of the markets are down, or, you know, the volatility or the instability and stuff like that. I recently retired, so I don't know, maybe I picked a bad time to retire because I've...
Tremendous volatility out there, no question.
What's that?
Tremendous volatility out there,
yeah,
no question.
Well, I mean, I would certainly like to be, you know, getting a better return on my portfolio, but I guess maybe that's just something I'm just going to have to live with, you know, being that I've retired and, you know, I've certainly seen it.
Well, here's the question. How long have you had your current portfolio?
That's a good question. Probably about 10 years.
What's the beta of your portfolio right now?
Oh, boy.
Okay, you probably don't know. This is the point that I want to make.
What
is the mean return? That's the average rate of return over the last 10 years.
Over the last 10 years, I'm not sure, but I think up until last year, I think from, 2010 through 2014, I was getting around 9%.
What's the standard deviation? Standard deviation is how much it varies from the average. Okay. Look, 99% of the people listening to this show cannot answer the questions I'm asking you right now, so don't feel alone.
Yeah.
Hardly anybody knows the answers to these questions. To determine whether your portfolio is a good portfolio or not, you need to know the answers to these questions. So you need to have a financial advisor that researches the portfolio for these kind of questions. And that doesn't happen most of the time. Sometimes, but very rarely. Okay?
Right.
So you need a second opinion in writing. You need an MRI of your existing portfolio to determine whether it's a solid portfolio or not. The fact that it went down a little bit last year is not a deciding factor, because just about everything did. It's how well did it do over the last 5 years?
Well, like I said, I think it's in about a 9% return.
If it got 9% average over the last 5 years, that's decent.
Yeah.
But at what risk? Was it risky or not? That I don't know.
No.
Because I don't know what standard deviation is. How did it compare to the market itself? Okay. Yeah. That's called beta.
Yeah.
A beta of 8 means it's 20% lower than the market itself, the benchmark or whatever you want to call it. If it's 1.2, it's 20% better than the market. So you had something to compare it to. Most people who talk to me, they haven't got the foggiest idea. Well, it's pretty good. I think I got a good advisor. Does the advisor do that? You need to talk to your advisor and say, Mr. Advisor, what do you do to select the securities that you're offering me? You're suggesting that I invest in this, 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 and this. How did you select those? What was the selection process? What software did you use to determine whether that's the top fund or not? Okay?
Yeah.
And people don't do that.
Well, no, he actually is pretty good. He does a lot of research. I hear things. I know people who have things in their portfolio, and you know, they seem to be doing fairly well. And I phone him up and I talk to him about them, and he researches them, and he does a lot of stuff like that. He's pretty good. But you know, the thing that I'm
what software does he use?
Oh God, I don't know. I'm really not a big computer.
Well, the best software that's out there that I'm aware of is called Morningstar Advisor Workstation. So if an advisor isn't using that or doesn't know how to use
you should ask
him why.
Yeah, I think he is using that because I just got a whole bunch of stuff from him not too long ago. I remember seeing the name Morningstar on the paper, on some of the paperwork. So, but what's disappointed me is the fact that the Liberal government have dropped the TFSA down from the 10,000 limit down to 5,500. That was really disappointing.
Yeah, at one point in one of his election campaigns, I heard him say he was going to double it.
Yeah, well, I'd have been fine.
that would have been great.
I'm not going to be able to invest as much money anymore as when I was working. But I mean, I was, you know, the past number of years, I've probably been putting in as much as 15,000. Well, now it's probably only going to be, you know, somewhere between maybe 7.5, 8, maybe as much as 10. And I thought, well, that's fine. I would pretty much put it all in a TFSA. But now it's, you know, he's lowered it down to 5,500. But I guess there's really not.
TFSA is one of the best things they ever did. It's too bad that you can't put more in, and it's too bad they decreased the contribution from last year.
Yeah, well, you can't do much about it. The government is, you know. But
what is it if you've never had one and you're married? You and between yourself and your spouse, you could put in $46,500 each.
Yeah. Well, I'm not married.
To catch up all the contributions that you missed.
Well, I'm not married, so since the TFA, since they first came out, I've contributed the maximum every year. So
well, that's a smart thing to do.
Pretty much, but anyways, I would really like to get a copy of that Think and Grow Rich book. That would be great.
Call Frieda.
Okay, thank you very much.
Appreciate the call.
Okay, right.
Bye bye. Okay, Danny's line is now vacant. Let's talk to Doug from Coquitlam. Doug, welcome to the program.
Oh, thank you very much.
Hi, Doug.
Hi. I'd like to call and get the book.
Okay. Any question? Any you want to contribute to the program in any way, shape, or form?
I was listening to it, and what came to my mind was for my daughter. I think it'll assist her greatly in how to survive and thrive in a difficult work situation that's coming from the top down. And so, you know, she's struggling with that, and I thought, well, you know, from listening to you and what your audience is saying and your guest, sounds like that book would assist.
I've been well known as a motivator over the years, many years I've been around, and I got all my stuff from this book.
Yeah, yeah.
I think it's fantastic.
You know, the logical thing is, well, you move on.
Tony Robbins, if you listen to Tony Robbins, a great motivational speaker, there's nothing new. It's straight out of this book.
Yeah, I had the freak opportunity when I was down in Scottsdale to run into his assistant and had a great conversation with her in a health food store.
Wow.
Yeah, yeah. But anyway, you know, in this market, it's hard just to switch jobs and to find something different. So you have to learn how to deal with what you are and you know, keep a positive attitude. So I thought, well, this book might help her out.
Doug, can't tell you how much I appreciate your call. And anybody else listening to the show, if you already have the book or you don't want the book for whatever, I can't imagine why not.
Yeah.
It doesn't mean you can't give it away to somebody else that needs the book.
Sounds good to me.
Okay.
Hey, thanks much for your time and appreciate your show.
Appreciate your call. You take care.
You too. Bye.
Okay, we have open lines right now, and in our remaining minutes, I'm just going to finish some of the ideas that I've been talking about. And this is about talking to your infinite intelligence. Last step here is make your desires clear and to reduce them to writing.
Yep, affirmations.
Okay. Put it down on a piece of paper. The best thing you could do right now is sit down at a table or a desk or wherever you are, take a piece of paper and write on the paper, call this number, 604-737-3512.
That's the positive
I will call this number today. That's an affirmation.
Today. Put okay. Today on
not
it.
Tomorrow, today.
Yeah.
Okay. Because Frida's down there just for you.
And when you write things, you anchor them to the universe. So
yes.
Write them down. Mm-hmm. Get it in writing.
Put it in writing, okay? That's the bottom line.
G-I-I-W. Get it in writing.
And then, on that same piece of paper, write, I will get myself a written financial plan. I will get the book, Think and Grow Rich, and I will read it.
And do it now.
I will do it now. Not tomorrow, not next week, but now.
In the present moment.
Okay?
Right.
Remember what I said earlier, yesterday is a canceled check, tomorrow's a promissory note, only today is money in the bank. The power of now, in capital letters, N-O-W.
And yesterday is history, tomorrow's a mystery, today is a gift. That's well said.
I like. Can I use that?
Huh?
Can I use that?
Certainly.
Good words. Okay. So here we are, and again, if you just tuned in, I'm certified financial planner, Fred Snyder, also registered financial planner, representing Scotia Wealth Management, changed from Scotia McLeod. We're here to help you accumulate money, to help you keep more of your hard-earned dollars, and most people don't do a very good job of that. Okay? We're not going to have time to get through the 20 sections of this one. I'm going to go to persistence. I have an icon here, really a good icon. I picked this up off the internet. Here's a picture of a crane swallowing a frog, and the frog is choking the crane. The frog is in the beak of the crane, and he's choking the crane, and it says, never give up.
Never give up.
Good. Never give up.
I believe that.
So I looked through an icon that I could use. That's the icon.
That's wonderful.
That frog is even though he's almost been swallowed, he's not giving up.
He's hanging in there.
Okay. And that's what you have to do. Can you give me examples of people that you know, Dr. Evers, that have given up?
Yes, and they give up, but to me, when the going gets rough, the tough get going, and that's what I do. Put one foot in front of the other and keep going.
Do you know anybody who succeeded because they were persistent?
Yes. Oh, many people. Many, many, many.
I think everybody who achieves success.
I
think that's the most important ingredient.
It is. Yeah, it is. It's one of the most important because if you don't keep you know, you start a job is actually more work than to finish it if you get excited about it. And excitement comes in, and you get excited about what you're teaching and doing, then it doesn't become a job anymore. It becomes fun.
There's 13 principles to achieve persistence. I'm not going to rhyme them off right now because time doesn't allow us to do that right now. We're just about out of time. But the 13, they're all in the book. So, again, you said you're going to get the book. Never give up. My stepson's license plate is right. That's his license plate. It says never give up.
I love it. That's okay. What I say too. Never give up.
So
there's always hope. Help open people's
you,
eyes.
You can fail. You get knocked down. The secret is to bounce right back up again.
Yep.
You never give up. Success may be within inches when you give up and you just don't realize it. You have to persist until you succeed.
It's
the last of the five
corner.
Motivational steps that I use on achieving anything, I'm not going to rhyme them off. I'm just going to go to step number five. Number five says to have the iron-willed determination to follow through and pursue your goals regardless of circumstances, criticism, or what other people say, think, or do.
Exactly.
That's how you achieve anything.
I totally agree.
Step five is persistence.
Persistence, yep.
Dr. Evers, I can't tell you how much I appreciate you being a guest on the show today.
Thank you.
And I can tell you you're welcome anytime. And you're now a member of my mastermind group,
yes,
expert
I
on the word
that.
Motivation.
Thank you. That's a great honor. Thank you, Fred.
So we'll see you all same time, same station next week. Bye for now.
If you'd like Fred to review your portfolio, call his office right now at 604-737-3512. That's 604-737-3512.